come together just like this.
Thank you.
to them this week. Come on and put them together this morning just like this. Come on, come on, all the way in the back. Help me this morning. Hey! To somebody, because we're about to get to a part of this song that says you are good all the time. Now I don't need somebody to sit there and just patty cake around, because I know we've been at the beach, we've been at summer waves and doing all that cool stuff, but the Lord's been good to you. Why is it summer waves, wasn't you, why you were doing? I said, so has he been good to you? Now somebody got something to praise him about this morning. There's somebody that got something to say, Lord, you've been good to me this morning. Now, we're gonna practice a little bit, just real quick. We're going to have a little practice. And then we're gonna take it home. All right, here we go. I need everybody to say this with me. Say you are good all the time. And all the time, you are good. It up. sets you on the way. How many's got a job to praise him about? How many's got money in the bank to praise him about? You may be running low, but how many's gonna give him a praise in advance this morning? Hey! How many's family members in church with him this morning? How many's babies in children's church this morning? He's good this morning. Now say you are good and all. Press in this morning, because he's been good. Yes, yeah. Hey. Yes, yeah. You are somebody. Come on, turn it on. Say it with me. You are good. Good to me, and I'm excited this morning. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands all over this place. Come on, just get a phrase on your lips. Begin to worship him if he's been good to you. Lord, we love you.
More of you, for the Lord is good. Yes, the Lord is good.
just one more time as Pastor Justin comes. For the Lord is and is loving. Yes, the Lord is good. And I'll shout and shout the mountains. He's still good today. Amen. Amen. Can you turn around two or three people and just say, it's so good to see you. Happy Independence Day. It's so good to see you. Happy July 4th holiday weekend. Thank you for coming to church. God is still good. Hallelujah. Y'all can jack the lights. If you can be seated after you shake those folks' hands and just meet and greet them today. It's so good to see you on this Sunday. I tell you, I'm a little bit in shock because I thought, man, it's just going to be me coming to church by myself today. Come on, somebody. But I'm so glad you're here, and what a beautiful Independence Day weekend crowd that's here to worship the Lord today. And I'm so excited you're here, and I can't wait to see what God's going to do today. And, you know, tomorrow is July the 4th where we celebrate Independence Day, and I don't know about you, you know, I had to wear my shirt because I really mean this thing, but I am proud to live and be a part of the United States of America. I think it's the greatest nation on earth. Come on, somebody. I think we have the best military, the best nation. And I'm just so thankful to be a part of it. And I just pray that God will continue to bless the great state of the United States of America. Just so thankful you're here today, and I hope tomorrow you just have a great, great time with your family and friends. And listen, I really don't have a whole lot of announcements I want to push, but before I push the main one I really want to push, our team has put together a wonderful welcome packet for first-time visitors. And so if you're in this room today and you'd say, Pastor, I'm a first-time visitor, maybe it's been a while since you've been home to Turning Point, I promise you we're not going to embarrass you, not going to throw your picture up on the screen or harass you. We just want to put one of these in your hand that gives you information about the ministry, different ways you can get involved, different things for you and your family. On the inside of it is a visitor card that you can fill out. It says, welcome home, and you can take that to the Bright Orange Connection tent out front. They'll hook you up with a free gift. But if that's you and you'd say, man, I'd like to get one of these, it's my first time, if you'll just raise your hand right there in that seat where you're at, the ushers will make sure you get one. Yes, God bless you for being here. If you'll just hold it up till they get it to you. And can we welcome all our first time visitors in this room and all those watching online being with us today? It's awesome for you to be here. We're just so privileged and honored you're here with us. Listen, the main thing I want to push before we receive the tithes and the offerings, I don't know if you've seen it online, they started the marketing for it to kind of get the word out. July the 31st, touch your neighbor, say July 31st. Come on, you didn't holler at them, say, come on, touch your neighbor for real. July 31st, July 31st, Sunday, July the 31st. I'm telling you from the bottom of my heart, is a Sunday you don't want to miss. Sunday, July the 31st is Turn Sunday. You say, preacher, what's this all about? We have had a beautiful history of ministry. In just a few short years, God has expanded this ministry from just a handful of people to now we minister, honestly, to over 1,000 people every week. If you count people in this building, those watching online, it's just incredible the influence God has given us. But on that Sunday, Turning Point is going to make a turn. We're going to make some changes so that we can see more lives changed by the gospel of Jesus. And I'm excited about it. I tell you, I really am. I'm just pumped about it. I wish I could tell you today, but it came. But we've got, on that day, we're going to share with you some incredible stuff that's coming up in the real imminent future, some things in the pipeline. I think it's really going to bless you, and you're going to be excited. And so I want to encourage you to be here on that turn Sunday as we prepare to make this turn. And I think it's just going to be a great, great history-making moment. I think it's some of the biggest news we've ever have shared on that Sunday, and you don't want to miss it. It's going to be great. Well, is there any blessed people in the building on this Sunday? Anybody blessed? I am. You and I today are living off the sacrifices of men and women from yesterday. Freedom is not really free. It costs somebody something, a life, blood to be shed for you and I to have freedom. Freedom is not really free. Somebody yesterday had to sacrifice and give so that we can enjoy what we have today. And I was thinking about it as I was preparing to give. I want to be somebody's sacrifice today, so they can experience the same freedom I have tomorrow. Y'all miss that? I'm not just talking about the freedom of being the citizen of the United States of America, because there is an even greater freedom than being a part of the United States of America, and it's being a citizen of a place called heaven. Come on, somebody. That's a freedom America can't even give you. Y'all ain't gonna help me up in here. And I was thinking about all the sacrifices that people made for me to be able to hear the message of Jesus. And everything we do at Turning Point is for one sole reason. It's so that people can experience a relationship with Jesus Christ. Somebody asked me this past week, they stopped me in Walmart. I was getting some burgers for the July 4th, and they said, Pastor, we're just so amazed by y'all's motivation at Turning Point. Why do y'all feed people? Why do y'all do outreach? Why do y'all do kids' crusades? Why do y'all build these buildings? Why do y'all do live stream? I said, it's easy. It's so that people just like me and you can experience a relationship and a freedom that's only found in Jesus Christ. And God has left the weight of the responsibility of making sure this message gets spread on your shoulders and my shoulders. And so today I want to challenge you to give your tithes, your offerings, with a sense of appreciation that God's going to take this offering that's about to be given, and somebody's going to experience a relationship with Jesus Christ because of seeds that have been sown from this place. So Lord, today in the name of Jesus, Lord, I thank you that I live in the greatest nation on earth. I thank you for this nation. And Lord, today I pray for the United States of America. Lord, I pray for my president. I pray, Lord, for vice president. I pray, Lord, for Congress and for Senate, for the House of Representatives. Lord, I pray, Lord, for all of the state officials, the local officials. Lord, I pray, God, for our amazing military, the men and women who sacrificed their lives so that we can be free. I pray, Lord, that you would bless this great nation. And Lord, today I pray as we give our tithes and our offerings in this room, and Lord, those giving online, I thank you, God, we're free because somebody made a sacrifice yesterday so we could be free today. And Lord, I pray today, let us give with a cheerful heart, knowing that somebody's going to experience a relationship with you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And somebody shout amen.
Dark.
Praise the Lord. If you got a Bible, if you would, grab it and stand with me all over this room if you're physically able. Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23. And then also Exodus chapter 19. I want to tear. Can y'all give them a big God bless you for helping me set this up today? And praise God. Thank you guys so much. I want to go ahead and apologize in advance before we read these scriptures. If maybe I don't seem as polished in my delivery today, it's because I got up at 7 o'clock this morning and God said, Justin, I need you to change your message. And so I've been up since 7 and just changed this thing. And today may not be one of those services where we hoop and take praise breaks, but I feel like it's my responsibility to deliver you what the Lord told me to tell you. And I think it's something our nation needs. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Just piggybacking off a little bit from last week. Above all else, guard your heart. For everything you do flows from it. Keep your mouth free from perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet. And be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or to the left, but keep your foot from evil. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. Before it ever becomes present in my life, it first had to get planted in my heart. And notice the wording he used. He didn't just say, watch your heart. He didn't just say, you know what, be conscious of your heart. He said, guard your heart. He said, put some things in place where you watch out what comes in your heart. And you make sure you put some guards at your heart to say, no, you can't come up in this heart. He said, guard your heart. He didn't just say pray for your heart or think about it. He said, guard your heart. Because if you let it get in your heart, it ain't going to be long before it gets in your life. In Exodus chapter 19, verse 9, it says, the Lord said to Moses, I'm going to come to you in the dense clouds of the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you. Moses told the Lord what the people had said. The Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day, because on that day I'm going to come down on Mount Sinai on the side of all the people. And look at verse 12. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you don't approach the mountain or touch the foot of it, because whoever touches the mountain is to be put to death. God told Moses, Moses, I love my people so much, I want you to build some fences, some boundaries, put some things up to guard my people. And I want you to tell them if they cross those fences that you put up, when I come down, they're going to die. So for the next few moments, I know you're going to eat with your family. I'm going to respect your time. But just for the next few moments, I want to teach / preach / holler that there is fences that bring freedom. Christianity has become known as the religion where you get a bunch of do's and don'ts, and we think God is trying to keep us from fun. I've learned that if you will let God put the fences in your life, He's not trying to keep you from fun. He's just trying to get some freedom to you. Y'all ain't gonna help me, but that's okay. So, Lord, today in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord, your word is already anointed, but knowing every ear in this building and the sound of my voice, Lord, to hear the word of the Lord today. Speak to us. Challenge us. God, I pray that when we leave this place today, we will take inventory of what's in our heart. And I pray today we'll establish some fences so you can bring freedom. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. And could you give him the best hand clap you've given him all morning long? Amen. You know, I get the amazing opportunity as a minister of the gospel to travel around and preach in different churches and capacities. And I usually get to do it quite a bit frequently throughout the year. This summer, I've actually declined a lot of invitations to spend time with my family and just really focus here at home at this church. But I, in the past, have gotten the amazing opportunity to travel around and preach in all different kinds of churches. I've preached in black churches. I've preached in white churches. I've preached in Methodist churches, Spirit-filled churches, AME churches, Baptist churches. If they lift up Jesus, I'll come hang out with them. Come on, somebody. And so I've been afforded the opportunity to be in a lot of different places with a lot of different people. And I was reflecting on it this past week that I'm starting to notice something for myself. I haven't read this in a statistic. I haven't gotten this from no theological professor or some latest culture update. It's just something I have observed for myself that I am seeing when it comes to churches all across America, that when it comes to this accepting Jesus, we're falling short in one area. Because you need to realize that when you come to God, there are two basic core things that should take place. And I think as ministers, we have just taken it for granted and assumed that people understand what these two basic core things that should happen in the life of every person who calls themselves to be a follower of Jesus Christ. But I think today if we look across our society, we have more Christians, they say, on earth than we ever have in any point in history, but our culture is decaying worse than it's ever been before. I knew there wasn't going to be no amens today. The first basic core when you accept Jesus as your Savior is you have to accept the love and the forgiveness of Almighty God. When you come to a point in your life where you realize, I am a sinner, I have messed up, I have made mistakes, I am in need of something higher and more powerful than I am, that can forgive me of my sins, that can forgive me of everything I've done wrong, that can wash me in a supernatural love, that can fill a void that I've tried every person, everything. I tried money. I tried buying stuff. I tried dating Rico. I tried the party. I tried the clubs. I tried everything I could to fill this void in my heart. But I finally realized stuff can't fill this void. I have to receive the love of God. There has to come a point where you realize that God loves you just the way you are. He is not in the business of just taking people who have it all together. God will take you just as you are. He will give you His love. He will give you His forgiveness. And you just have to make up your mind and believe by faith, God loves me with my jacked up self. He loves me with my issues. He loves me with my mess, my circumstances. And you just have to say, God, I receive your love. I believe that you have forgiven me, that you're not going to hold my past over me. And you have to make the decision by faith. God loves me. He has forgiven me. And if you know that to be true, give your God a praise right here if you're thankful. Oh, some of y'all need to be clapping a little extra better because you know God had to forgive you a whole lot of stuff. I wish I could get some help up in here. God had to forgive me of a whole lot of stuff. So the first thing you have to do when you become a Christian is you have to accept by faith that God loves me and He has forgiven me. And that is so freeing to know that God is not going to consult your past to determine your future. But there's a second part that we don't preach about much anymore, that I felt a huge burden and a responsibility to drive it home today. We have a responsibility when we receive the love and the forgiveness of God and receive it by faith. That is not where the equation ends in this relationship with God. There's a second thing that we must do according to the scriptures. That's a word that's called repent. Yeah, help me, Jesus. Repent does not mean to just ask for forgiveness. I'm afraid we are raising up a culture of Christians today in the United States of America where all we do is come to church and ask for forgiveness and get some fire insurance so we don't go to hell. And then we leave the doors of the church and say, now, can I do this and still go to heaven? How far can I cross the line and still get to heaven? Y'all just look straight ahead. I'm going to find you in a minute. But you need to understand that whenever you receive the love, acceptance, and forgiveness of Almighty God by faith, there should be a second part to that equation where you repent. Oh, good God Almighty. Repent does not mean you just come down to the altar and tell God you're sorry for everything you've done and then go back out there and do what you were asking Him to forgive you of when you did it to begin with. That just don't make no sense if you really just sit down and think about it. Come on, somebody. God is not in the business of just making your conscience feel better. God is in the business of changing your heart, because He knows if He can change your heart, He'll end up changing your life. And God says, I don't just need you to come to me and receive my love, acceptance, of forgiveness, but there should be a part in the life of every believer where you repent. Repent means to turn away from. It means to go in the opposite direction. It means to change one's thought, change one's thinking. It means to do a 180-degree turn in the opposite direction. It means that whenever you receive the love, acceptance, and forgiveness of God, repentance means I'm going to do an inventory of my life and see what can I find that is displeasing to God, and I am going to do everything I can not to keep it in my life, but I'm going to do everything I can to get it out of my life. Oh, y'all ain't gonna help me up in here, so I can be everything God has designed me to be. But we are living in a culture today where Christianity, we are trying to make it where we conform it to the world's teachings. Now, y'all get quiet, but y'all, when God says something, He is not fickle like you and I are. He doesn't care what the culture is. He doesn't care what they voted in the legislation. He doesn't care what the Supreme Court says. He don't even care what the President of the United States says. He cares what His word says, and He establishes His word, and He says, my word will last. He said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word is going to stand forever. And it doesn't matter what I feel. It doesn't matter my emotions. It doesn't matter what I want for my own life. Christianity is not about pleasing me. Christianity is about me receiving the love, acceptance, and forgiveness from Almighty God. And then every day of my life, I am crucifying this flesh, saying, Justin Mitchell, it's not about you. It's about Jesus. It's about doing what He's called me to do. And sometimes that means I don't get to do what I want to do. Y'all ain't gonna help me up in this building today. So it's not just enough to receive God's forgiveness, but there should be repentance. And repentance is not just asking for forgiveness. God told Moses, Moses, I am coming down. And I want you to build a fence around the mountain. Now, this is a baby fence. Can I get a witness up in here? I want you to put a fence around the mountain. And you tell the people, there's a point where I'm coming. And you tell them that if I come down and they have stepped over what I told them not to step over, they're going to die. Above all else, guard your heart. I struggled with this past week because I even found myself kind of arguing with God, because I was like, God, this book called the Bible is just a bunch of rules of what we can't do and what we can do. And if God, all we gonna do when we get to heaven is sit up on the cloud with a harp and sing praises all day long, that might sound fun to you. That sounds boring to me. Come on, somebody. And God, there's sometimes when I look at the world and I see everything they get to do, they're living how they want to live, they're dating who they want to date, they're conducting their marriage how they want to conduct their marriage. Y'all ain't gonna help me up in here. They're drinking what they want to drink, they're smoking what they want to smoke, they're going where they want to go. They're spending their money on this, on these websites and these videos, and Lord, they're cussing each other out, and it just looks like they're having a whole lot better time than I am. Can we be real? And God spoke to me, said, Justin, fences are not designed for boredom. They're designed for freedom. Good God, am I? You see, we are in a temporary different state of living in my home. We sold our old home, and we're living in a temporary place. And when we were looking at different places to live in temporarily, one of the important things to us was that there would be a fence in the backyard. Come on, roll with me, somebody. And you say, preacher, why did you want a fence? Number one, because I have a dog, Bow Wow Wow. And number two, I have a 20-month-old who you can tell her to stay in one spot, but she ain't standing in one spot. Come on, somebody. And so we wanted a fence, not necessarily to contain her within a space, but it's because we realized and we've come to the understanding that a fence brings us as parents a sense of freedom, because it keeps the bad guys out. It keeps the animals out. Y'all hear what I'm saying? It keeps the perverts from looking in. And it allows us to enjoy our time with our daughter in a way that we couldn't enjoy it if we had to worry about all this stuff getting in, looking in, and trying to obstruct our relationship with our daughter. Y'all rolling with me? And so God says, I want to put some fences around your life, not because I'm trying to keep you from having fun, but because I want you to be able to live with a sense of freedom that you can enjoy your relationship with me and not have to worry about stuff or people or things coming in to your heart, into your life, into your relationship with me, and causing it to never be what it can never have been if you'd have never had the fence around you. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I'm about to talk real, real plain, so you might want to cover your ears if you don't want to hear this. I'm a Christian. I love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and body. I love him. This isn't just something I do on Sunday. I praise him every day of my life. When my feet hit the floor in the morning, I'm going to have a hallelujah coming out my mouth. Because I realize I'm only here because of the goodness of the Lord. And I don't want to just have a religion. I want some relationship with my God. But there have been times. Oh, good God, help me, Jesus. There have been times, even as a Christian, where I didn't guard my heart the way I should have guarded my heart. The Bible said above all else, guard your heart, because everything you do flows from it. Okay? There have been times, now maybe not you, pray for your weaker brother, but there have been times in my life where I have opened up the door of my heart. I have a fence around it. I've got some personal convictions, just some things that, you know, I don't think it affects you, but it's the stuff I believe in and stuff I, you know, strive for. But there have been times when I have gotten kind of lax in guarding the door of my heart, that I have just left the door open and some things have crept in that should have never been there to begin with. Maybe it was a song I should have never listened to. Maybe it was people. Maybe it was a conversation. Maybe it was a movie. Y'all gonna help me up here? But I've let some stuff creep in through the door of my heart before, and it's gotten inside of my heart, and it should have never been there to begin with. And it's not the devil's fault it got in there. I'm about to bust some theological bubbles up in here. But I don't believe the devil can just come in and attack us whenever he wants to. Because there would be no such thing as a hedge of protection if he could. I think he has to get permission from God. Go ask Job. Come on, somebody. But I don't believe the devil can just come in whenever he wants to come in. I think 95% of the stuff we blame on the devil and demons, I think it's our fault for leaving the door open to our heart and not guarding it like we should. Say, ho, drinking, no, you can't come up in here. Partying, no, get out. Boom, come on, somebody. I think 95% of the stuff we try to blame on everybody else is a lack of us guarding our heart. And I'm going to be real with you. When I have allowed stuff to come in my heart that never had any business being there, it affected my relationship with God. I didn't say it affected my salvation. Y'all ain't gonna help me up in here. Because no man can pluck me out of his hand. But it affected my relationship with God. What do you mean, preacher? I mean, there's been some times in services where I have allowed some stuff in my heart. Maybe it's bitterness. Maybe it's anger. Maybe it's unforgiveness. Maybe it's conversation. You fill in the blank for whatever it is you've allowed to just walk up in your heart before. But if you'd be real honest, there have been some things you have allowed to take residence in your heart that should have never been there. When you come to worship experience like this and you try to praise God, but you really just can't praise him like you want to praise him, because you know you got some stuff in your heart that ain't got no business being there. Y'all ain't gonna help me, but I'm just gonna tell you the truth. There's been some times I've been wanting to clap in the service, but I just couldn't clap because I knew I'd be a hypocrite, because I got some stuff up in my heart that has no business being up in my heart. And I've tried to worship before and go to a deeper level of intimacy with God, but I couldn't go there, not because God wasn't ready, but because I let some stuff up in my heart that had no business being in there. And so God says, hey, because I don't want my relationship with you to suffer, I want some fences around your heart. I want some standards. That's something we don't hear in America anymore. I want some standards according to my word. Not a culture, not what's popular, not what's new or what is trending. But what's in my word? And you use my word to determine what comes in your heart and what stays out of your heart. Because if you will allow my standards to fill your heart, Justin Mitchell, you can experience a relationship and a freedom with me that you could never experience if you just let anything or anybody come in your heart. And so, you know, in our backyard, man, I'm down there playing. I'm playing with Ellie. I'm having a good time with her. Man, I'll do crazy stuff I would never do in public. Come on, somebody. I mean, I will talk crazy junk. She'll say, Daddy, get down. I'll get down. I wouldn't do that in public, but I just get down. I'll roll in the dirt. I'll play in the toys. I wouldn't do that if other people could see me. Come on, somebody. What I'm saying is that fences allow you and I to experience a relationship and a freedom with God that we can't have if we just let whoever and whatever come in our life. I have personal convictions. I'm getting ready to land this plane in a minute. I have personal convictions. They're not things I preach or demand publicly because I can't prove it entirely in the scriptures. But I have personal convictions. I have personal fences I have set up in my home that are a standard, maybe not for your house, but they're a standard for my house. I have a fence in my home that alcohol is not allowed. We do not social drink in my house. And it's not just because I don't want it to be a foothold to me, but I don't want somebody to come in my home who struggles with that addiction and me be the one who opened up the door for their heart for the devil to trap them again. Come on, somebody. I love y'all too much to do that. There are websites I don't look at. There are TV shows we don't watch. There are movies, if they use my God's name in vain, I leave the movie theater or we turn it off our television. That's just a standard from my house. It's a fence. Well, preacher, why? Because I don't want to get numb to those things where it numbs my relationship with God. His name is precious to me. Come on, somebody. So lastly, one little point I want us to home with you. Mark chapter 4. There's a lot of scriptures, but roll with the punches. Remember, everything flows out of our life. It started in our heart. And he said, above all else, guard your heart. You are responsible for what comes in, and you are responsible for what stays out. So catch this. Again, Jesus began to teach by the sea, and a great multitude was gathered to him, so that he got into a boat, and he sat in on the sea, and the whole multitude was on the land facing the sea. Verse 2, it says, then he taught them many things by parables, and he said to them in this teaching in Mark chapter 4, he said, listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. Verse 4, roll me fast, Sister Mary. And it happened as he sowed that some seed fell by the wayside. The birds of the air came and devoured it. Then some fell on stony ground where it did not have much earth, and it immediately sprang up because it had no depth of the earth. And verse 6, he said, but when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. Then I want you to go down to verse 15. He starts explaining this parable. Because Jesus gives this parable, the people leave, and the disciples are like, hey, great, great message, but we have no idea what you was talking about. Can you please decode it for us? And he says, here's what it's all about. He said, the sower sows the word. The seed is the word. Words are seeds. Good God Almighty. Words are seeds, and they may not affect you today, but if you let them get planted in the ground of your heart, These are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown, and when they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. So words don't just affect my ears. Words affect my heart. God Almighty. I'm about to push you off a cliff and leave you there. Come on, somebody. Jesus said the seed is the word. And words don't just affect the ears. Words get planted in the heart. Oh, good God Almighty. And I am responsible for what takes up residence in my heart. And so life will throw you and I some seed. It will throw us some word. A daddy who didn't love you will come by and say, you ain't gonna amount to nothing. You're sorry just like your mama. You're never gonna make it. You're never coming off the drugs. You're never coming off the alcohol. You're gonna sleep around just like your mama slept around. Y'all gonna help me up in here? What is happening? Seed is getting sown into your heart. And you have a decision to make, because it's up to you to guard what comes in and what comes out. And so you have to make a decision and say, the devil is a liar. I rebuke that seed in the name of Jesus. It ain't getting planted in my heart. It ain't getting planted in my mind, in my life, because I will not have that kind of a harvest in my life. Because catch this, your heart is neutral. It don't care what you put in it. Your heart is designed to push up whatever you put in it. That ground out there don't care if I put an apple tree in it. It don't care if I put an orange tree in it. It don't care if I put some dogwood or some sticky bushes. Come on, some. It don't care. The ground is going to receive whatever seed I put in it, and it's just going to push it to the top. Good God Almighty. Preacher, why in the world do I have so much hate in my life? Preacher, why do I have such relational issues? Preacher, why do I have such an identity disorder in my life? It's because somewhere along the way, some seed got planted in your heart, and it's just been pushed to the top. And religion will focus on what's been pushed to the top. But God said, I'm not like man that I look on the outward appearance, but I look at the heart of a matter, because I realize if I want to change your life, I got to change your heart. Come on, somebody. That's why the Pharisees couldn't understand Jesus, because they wanted him to go around and judge people's outward expression. But Jesus said, I didn't come to judge the fruit. I came to lay the axe to the root, because I know the problem isn't what's happening in their life. The problem is what they have allowed to come up in their heart and be planted, and now the heart is just pushing it to the top. And so I got to get rid of some seed. I got to get rid of selfishness. I got to get rid of doubt, insecurity, sin, addiction, hatred, unforgiveness. If I can get it out of their heart, it's only a matter of time until their life starts looking like their heart. So hear me. This is why Jesus took fences to a whole other level. And I'm closing. Y'all come help me. Jesus said, you have heard, if you commit adultery with a woman, you have sinned. But I tell you that if you look at a woman and lust, you have already committed adultery. Where? In your heart. Because if it gets in my heart and it stays planted, it's only a matter of time until it gets in my life. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? I tell you, people say, well, how in the world could people go down to Orlando and just shoot people up with an assault rifle? How can parents kill their children? How can teenagers like we've never seen before be so confused with their identity. Why in the world is our marriages at a 60% divorce rate in the church? Why do we have more Christians than any other point in history? But we've got more moral decay than we ever have in our history. It's because we have become lax in guarding our heart. And God says, I'm not trying to keep you from fun. I'm trying to keep you from pain. Because I thought about it. I ministered to this guy. I can't tell you his name. Wouldn't do that to anybody. Had this guy well known in town. Came to me privately. On the outside, he looks amazing. Money in the bank. Beautiful family. Business galore. And he came to me in private. He said, hey. He says, I've never been to Turning Point. He says, I've never even been to a spirit-filled church. He said, but I need help. He says, my marriage is a wreck. He said, my money's getting funny. He says, I can't sleep at night. I have no peace. He says, my relationship with my dad, I thought I was over it, but it's still affecting me. He says, I'm battling stuff. And he said, will you pray for me right here in this parking lot, preacher? He says, because I need some of that power to turn the points, Scotty. He says, I'm coming, but I need some of that power. And what he was asking for is what all of us need. We don't just need God's love, acceptance, and forgiveness. We need repentance. We need a God who will establish a fence for us. And here's what I love about my God. He said, I'm a very present help in the time of trouble. If I ever let some stuff get up in my heart that should never be there, I'm not battling this stuff by myself. I have a God who is with me, and he will help me get the stuff out of my heart. He'll help me get the wrong people. He'll give me the grace to say, hey, I'm not judging you. I just can't have you in this season of my life. What are you? I'm trying to be a better me. I just can't have you right now. I can't date you. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I can't go to those parties no more. I'm sorry. No, I can't fool around with that stuff. Why? Because I got a fence in my heart, and I want to experience God's freedom. So stand with me. I love this room. No one looking, no one leaving. Please respect the Holy Spirit. I think God is calling this church, this nation, to repentance. If you are under the sound of my voice and you say, I want some freedom, I want my relationship with God to be He designed it to be. We're not going to judge you. We're not going to look down on you. This is not judging whether you're saved or not saved, because there's saved people who need to repent. But if you were in this place and you would say to your God, God, today I want these fences up. God, put some standards. And God, I got to tell you, I got some stuff in there that should be there. I need you to help me get it out. If that's you, on the count of three, I want you to leave that chair, come to this altar, and repent. One, come on, we're not going to judge you. Two, people's already coming. Three, come on, 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 come on. Some of you let the wrong people in your heart. You need to come and repent. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Not going to judge you. This is for you, baby. This is for you, precious. Come on, come on, come on. I know there's more than this. 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 Come on, come on, come on. I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting. You said if he'd ask one more, I'm asking you one more time. Come, 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 come.
Yes, Lord, is forever.
Come on, if you're at this altar, just raise your hands to God. Come on, just cry out to him. I can't do this part for you. This is personal for you. You got to ask him to set the fence around your heart. You got to say, God, I give you permission to get everything out that needs to stay out and keep everything in that needs to stay. This is between you and God. I can't help you here, honey. You got to do this. You got to take responsibility for yourself. Come on, if you're in the congregation, can we worship? Come on, can we worship while God ministers singing, Jordan singing? Over every man, over every woman at this altar, in the name of Jesus. God, I pray as they cry out to you, God, that you would give them the strength and the grace, God, to remove everything from their heart that needs to be removed. God, in the name of Jesus, remove every hurt. God, remove every disappointment. God, remove every bad relationship. God, remove the pain and the seeds of the molestation, God. God, in the name of Jesus, the rape, in the name of Jesus, God. I pray, God, you do a deep work in your people today. I speak freedom to your soul in the name of Jesus. Come on, deep cries out to deep. Oh, I cry out for the depths of your soul right now that God would set you free. Oh, that God would bring you freedom. That whom the Son sets free is not just free in your mind, but you're going to be free in your heart. Oh, good God Almighty. That you're not just going to experience freedom in your salvation, but you're going to have freedom down in the depths of your heart. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, he said, I've come that you might have life. Not just to save life, but an abundant life. A life full of freedom. A life free from frustration. A life free from failure and shame. I speak it in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Forgiveness.
you need to repent. Part of repentance is not just turning away from, it's putting up a fence so you don't have the option of going back. Preacher, I don't believe it. When they brought Jesus, the woman caught in the act of adultery, what did he say? Daughter, your sins are forgiven, and repent and sin no more. I'm being transparent with you. I have fences in my life. When I go to prayer time and study time with God, I don't take my phone. Why? I'm guarding my heart in my time with God. I have guards over different areas of my life. Facebook, you can't private message me on Facebook. You know why? Because I've had females try to send me seductive stuff. I ain't got no time for that. Come on, somebody. And so we just shut it off. That's a fence. Can I get some help in here? I don't ride alone with any woman. Somebody else has got to be in the car. That's a fence. Y'all gonna help me? If you're in this room and you're struggling with pornography, you need to get a fence. Filter, turn the computer, internet off, something. Come on, somebody, you need a fence. Because if it gets planted in your heart, re-preach this, but it's going to end up in your life. So Lord, today in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that your people have heard my heart today. God, this was not preached in condemnation or shame or judgment, but Lord, it was preached from a heart of experience. It's preached from a heart. God is a shepherd that wants to see your sheep experience freedom with you. God, that we can be in a place in our relationship with you, we don't have to worry about stuff coming in and reaping, God, stuff that we never even wanted to be sowed. God, I speak freedom over every man, over every woman. And God, I pray you would give us the wisdom to establish some fences. In Jesus' name, I pray. If you receive it, will you give God a big hand clap of praise? I love